Good evening. Welcome, bienvenue, et merci d'être parmi nous ce soir. Thank you for joining us for the fourth Integrated Management Symposium, Leadership During Economic Crisis. My name is Isabelle Bageux, and I'm the Dean of the Desautels Faculty of Management here at McGill University. And it's my pleasure to introduce today's speakers and the themes for discussion. First, allow me to give you some background on this event. The Integrated Management Symposium series is a premier initiative of the Marcel Desautels Institute for Integrated Management. These leadership discussions bring thought leaders to campus to exchange on interdisciplinary management topics while also helping us to better understand the practice of management and empower managers to make an impact, both within their organizations and in society. I'm so pleased that Mr. Shaun Donovan is here to share his experience with us. The way that someone manages a crisis reveals a lot about their character, how they cope with unknowns, their degree of resilience and adaptability, and the soundness of their judgment. Our distinguished guest this evening has not only managed some of the most significant crises in recent US history, but has also shaped key policies to drive positive social impact. Under the Obama administration, Mr. Donovan was brought on as the 50th United States Secretary of Housing and Urban Planning from 2009 to 2014. He took on this role in the middle of the housing crisis, leading complex negotiations for mortgage service settlement and establishing $50 billion in assistance for homeowners and communities. Thereafter, he was promoted and sworn in as Director of the Office of Management and Budget of the United States government from August 2014 until the conclusion of the Obama administration. As such, he ran the largest unit within the Executive Office of the President and was responsible for producing the US government budget and measuring the quality and compliance of agency programs, policies, and procedures. During this time, he also led two especially impactful initiatives: the Hurricane Sandy Task Force to respond to the destruction left behind by the storm, and secondly, the Opening Doors Initiative in support of homeless veterans. Prior to joining the Obama administration, Mr. Donovan worked in the private sector on financing affordable housing and served as commissioner of the New York City Department of Housing Preservation and Development. He holds 3 degrees from Harvard University, a Bachelor of Arts from Harvard College, a Master of Public Administration for the John F. Kennedy School of Government, and a Master of Architecture from the Graduate School of Design. Needless to say, we are very grateful to Shaun for taking time to be with us today. We are equally delighted to have Sebastien Betermier, Assistant Professor of Finance at the Desautels Faculty of Management, join us for this event. Professor Betermier's research examines the relationships between risk and return and how these drive investors in their decisions. He has published his findings in top finance journals and has received several distinctions, including lead article in the Journal of Finance in 2017. If Professor Betermier is a leading researcher in his field, he has also been recognized repeatedly for teaching excellence, including as the recipient of the Desautels Distinguished Teaching Award. Professor Betermier holds a PhD in finance from the Haas School of Business at the University of California at Berkeley. Thank you, Sebastien, for being there. Shaun and Sebastien will exchange for about an hour before the floor will open for questions. I'll return for closing remarks, and I hope you'll join us afterwards for a cocktail reception in the next room. Finally, before turning the event over to our speakers, I'd like to recognize the generous gift of Marcel Desautels that has made this symposium series possible. His contributions, along with the gift from our faculty's alumni and friends, enable us to offer accessible opportunities for knowledge sharing of the highest order. Merci, Marcel. Thank you and enjoy.
Well, good evening, everyone. Thank you all for joining us tonight. Thank you, Dean Badger, for the opening remarks. Special thanks to you, Mr. Donovan, for taking the time to come to McGill and sharing your insights with us. This is going to be a discussion on leadership during times of economic crisis. As Secretary of HUD, the Housing and Urban Department, from 2009 to 2014, Mr. Donovan helped lead the US through the Great Recession. I want to spend 1 minute to talk about what this means. We're talking about the greatest economy in the world. We're talking about one of the largest crises in the history of the country. We're talking about a crisis that was unprecedented in terms of the scale and the complexity. Mr. Donovan, we're in February 2017 today. The crisis was only a few years away, but it's over. The economy is doing well on the whole today, and that's thanks to you in large part and your team and other leaders of the Obama administration.
And the president gets a little credit for that as well.
And the president gets a little credit. And so I'd like to begin this discussion by saying thank you for taking on this huge responsibility. And I'd like to give, actually to begin, a warm round of applause to Mr. Shaun Donovan for, in recognition of the magnitude of the accomplishment that we're talking about here.
I should come to Montreal more often.
Yes, please. So part one of this discussion will be to learn from what it was like to lead through the recession. Part two of this discussion will be regarding other crises. As leader of HUD, Mr. Donovan also helped to lead the US through two other crises, and I should say very different types of crisis. There is the veteran homelessness crisis, and there is Hurricane Sandy. They're quite different. One is a narrow problem with a clear feedback loop. The other is a much more open-ended problem with limited feedback loop. And so the second part of this discussion will be to talk about your managerial skills and how you were able to adapt to the various environments. Let's begin with the Great Recession, this baptism of fire of entering mid-crisis as a new leader. And before I leave this to you, I'm going to begin by giving all of you a brief recap of what it was like back in January 2009. The economy was worsening. An unemployment rate was going up, topping up 8% at the beginning of the year. The stock markets are down 40% compared to the year before. About 25% of the subprime mortgages are becoming delinquent. More than 1 million households lose their job in 2008 alone, and that number is going up, as the graph shows. The crisis becomes so severe that Freddie Mac and Fannie Mae, the two gigantic housing finance intermediaries that owned and guaranteed more than $5 trillion of mortgages, well, in September 2008, they were placed under conservatorship. That's a fancy word for temporary nationalization. They received up to $200 billion of bailout funds from the US Treasury. This unprecedented federal intervention exacerbated the political polarization. The following video clip comes from Rick Santelli from CNBC in February 2009. It quintessentially represents the economic attitudes of the Tea Party that was born during that time.
How about this, President and new administration? Why don't you put up a website to have people vote on the internet as a referendum to see if we really want to subsidize the losers' mortgages, or would we like to at least buy cars and buy houses in foreclosure and give them to people that might have a chance to actually prosper down the road and reward people that could carry the water instead of drink the water?
Hey, Rick,
that's a novel idea.
Hey, Rick.
Welcome aboard.
Yeah.
So we're in February 2009.
I'm having flashbacks. I really appreciate the opening.
You're confirmed by Senate in February 2009. Could you tell us how those first few weeks went and what it was like, the complexity and the impossibility of the situation that you faced?
So maybe I'll roll back a little bit farther in time. I was... Isabel mentioned that I was the housing commissioner in New York City. Mike Bloomberg was mayor. And you may have heard stories about the way he organized his office. He set up this bullpen, very much like a trading floor from his earlier time on Wall Street. And literally, he had his tiny little cubicle in the middle of all the senior people who worked in City Hall. And on the one end of this ornate old hearing chamber where the bullpen was located, he had a giant television screen. And usually, it was showing, you know, how many potholes had been filled that day. It was a very Bloombergian kind of thing, with data from everything happening in the city that was up there every day. Well, this was the day that the U.S. Congress was trying to pass the original bailout, the program that would rescue the economy. And literally at the very moment that it became clear that it was going to fail in the U.S. Congress, Mike Bloomberg walked into the chamber and said, "The world is ending." And everybody went silent. And that was the kind of feeling we all had. That was the feeling President-elect Obama had. I went in and interviewed with him in Chicago a week after the election. And he was months away from being president, but you could see the entire weight of the world's largest economy. In fact, in many ways, the entire world economy was at risk at that time. And I remember Mike Bloomberg, when I told him I was going to be housing secretary for President Obama, he looked at me like I was crazy for taking the job. But the other thing that I would say, just to give a sense of the magnitude of the problem, it wasn't just that this was the biggest crisis that we'd seen in our economy, certainly in the housing markets, since the Great Depression. It was that the complexity, as you said, Sebastien, of the problem. If you were trying to save somebody's house, which we were trying to do, and I want to come back to that in a moment, the idea that when you went to look at who owned that mortgage, it was literally owned in so many cases by a countless number of investors spread all across the globe with very little idea of who was in charge, right? There were these incredibly complex, very new financial instruments that were part of what happened in the crisis and part of what led to the crisis. And so unwinding this situation was almost incomprehensible in its complexity. And that's, in many ways, the sort of center of what we were facing. I think the other thing, just to personalize it a little more, you know, sitting where President Obama sat, sitting where we all sat in the cabinet, the speed of decision making we needed to make, it was literally like every day we were making an announcement that on its own would have been one of the most significant announcements that an administration might make in the first year. And yet, day after day, on the auto companies trying to rescue them, many, many different markets, not only the housing market. This week is actually the 8th anniversary of the housing plan that we announced. But it felt like every day we were needing to make those decisions. And I think the final thing, and that really goes to the clip that you showed, the politics of this were quite brutal. Literally, you mentioned it, but many people date the beginning of the Tea Party in the United States to that very clip that you watched, that Rick Santelli's rant on the floor of the Chicago Mercantile Exchange was the sort of birth moment of the Tea Party. And so it wasn't just the complexity of what the issues we're dealing with, it was this sense of the fundamentally moral question about who is deserving or not deserving of help. And whatever our own beliefs were, and I will, I'm sure, come back to my own beliefs, if in the very first few weeks of the president's time in office, we lost a large share of the American public in terms of their support, that was an irreconcilable problem for us. And so it was the economic complexity, the speed of decision making, the scale of decision making, but also at the same time, the complexity of the politics and the moral questions that we were dealing with that is unlike anything I've ever come across, and I, you know, hope we'll ever have to deal with again.
So let's begin with the early efforts to rescue the crisis, since we're on the topic. Many of the initiatives were there to help the borrowers. One of the initiatives was called HARP, the Home Affordable Refinance Program, targeted about 45 million homeowners and trying to help them refinance their home to take advantage of the lower rates, and also to convert to the fixed rate mortgages that were more stable. And then you also had HEMP, the Home Affordable Modification Program, targeting 3 to 4 million at-risk homeowners and providing them with debt forgiveness. Now, HEMP at first struggled to get some early action. This is an article in CNN in September 2009 that says, well, 6 months into the program, only 6% of the 4 million eligible homeowners have gotten help. Why was it so difficult to get traction early on?
Yeah, and I think it's helpful in doing this to contrast this with some of the other things. You mentioned HARP. There were many other efforts as well that we undertook to help whole communities that were being devastated by foreclosures. But I think HAMP is the best example of the one that was most complex. And just a little more specifics, HARP was the program to help people who were able to pay their mortgages to refinance. So let's say your home is worth $100,000. But your mortgage is $120,000. No lender is going to say to you, well, I'm willing to refinance your mortgage because the mortgage is higher than the value of the house. But these were generally folks that the American people saw as responsible. They were paying their mortgages each month. They were able to afford those mortgages. And so in some ways, it was a simpler problem, right? We had to find investors to figure out how to get alignment among investors, but it didn't have quite the same level of complexity where not only with HAMP, what we were doing was helping restructure mortgages where somebody wasn't able to pay. And there, you're actually asking someone to forgive debt, so it's a harder question with the investors. But the moral questions, those are the folks that Rick Santelli is talking about in that clip. Those are the people that many saw as undeserving. And so the complexity was higher. Literally, we had to figure out in a world where, you know, these pooling and servicing agreements, all the complexity behind these newfangled mortgage instruments, we had to figure out when, you know, things go wrong, the things they'd never anticipated, what happens when house prices drop by 50% in a neighborhood. That was never anticipated in these documents. Who would control? Who would get to make decisions? So there was an incredible complexity about just trying to solve the problem and trying to figure out how to sort of untie the Gordian knot, if you will. But then there's a further challenge, which is, and we had this debate very much within our own team, who should get help? If someone had bought a second or a third house, they weren't actually living in the house, should they get help or not? And you can imagine those kinds of, if they're working or not working, employed, there are 100 different variations of these kind of moral hazard questions that we dealt with, very different opinions within the team. And I think the, obviously very different opinions among the American people, but the problem is this isn't just, if my house loses 10, 20, 30% of its value, the consequences aren't just for me, they're for my neighbors as well. Because when the value of my house goes down, it starts to have an effect on the entire neighborhood. And that's the essence of the moral quandary. I can't remember who started it, but one of the things we used to say among many in the cabinet, Ben Bernanke and others who were working on this problem, was, well, when your house is on fire, the firefighters don't come in and ask whether you were smoking in bed before they turn the hoses on. Right? And so the issues really become ones of trade-off of deserving versus, and I will say, I think the mistakes that we made early on were probably to go too much in the direction of trying to get those moral questions precisely right. And I think there's a, oftentimes, I think this is true in leadership in general, but I think it's particularly true in the public sector, that you can have an illusion in seats of power that the machinery that you control can get things perfectly when it can't. And so often, one of the reasons it was slow to get started, if we decided, we did decide that somebody had to be a homeowner living in their home to get help. We had to decide that we had to look at their income and figure out that it was going to be sustainable, that they were going to be able to pay it back. And a whole set of things that meant they've got to fill out a few forms, right? These are folks who are getting bombarded by bills. Often they're putting their heads in the sand and don't want to answer them, open the mail. And so there were lots of just mechanical issues, basic issues about getting forms filled out and other things. And ultimately, the program actually ended up reaching almost as many people as we targeted. It took longer than we would have liked. And over time, we started to peel back some of those layers of screening and other things that we did, largely because I think we came to understand that the greater good here, the bigger problem, was what was facing the firefighter, that we needed to put out the fire. And whether someone was, you know, made a mistake and caused that fire or not was of lesser importance than listening to Rick Santelli and extinguishing, you know, only for those who were deserving of the help.
So given the fact that you just came into the government and you had this impossibly complex situation literally on your plates, how did this position hampered your ability to do decision making, let's say, regarding the initial design of hemp?
Yeah. So I mentioned that I interviewed with the president a week after the election. I was named to be HUD secretary in early December. Mm-hmm. You can imagine I've got about 6 weeks before I take office. There's a whole campaign team, advisors and others that had been working with the president. I had done some work on the campaign, but very limited because I had a day job in New York City running housing for the mayor. And so I found myself stepping into this situation, you know, and around the table, not only President Obama, but Larry Summers and Ben Bernanke and a whole range of others that are, you know, completely focused on the economic crisis, housing being a big part of that. And so I was faced with the question, where can I add value? And I think particularly as you think about what makes leadership teams work, what makes people able in times of crisis to function effectively, a huge amount of that is trust. A huge amount of that is knowing who it is that's sitting across from the table, whether you can trust their judgment, but also trust that they have their motives are ones of solving the problem, not turf or any of the other things that can come up. And I didn't have any of that, right? I was stepping into, I knew a few of the folks from the campaign, but not well enough, and certainly not well enough to be tested in the biggest economic crisis of our lifetimes. And so there were some very difficult issues about, for me personally, figuring out sort of how to intervene and what to do. And the truth is, I did have concerns about some of the complexity and sort of over-design of HAMP in particular. Mm-hmm. I was kind of the view that we should be more aggressive early on, but thought that it was going to be very hard for me to move that group of people to a different position, partly because a lot of those opinions had been formed over time in the campaign. And part of it that I was new. Part of it, I think, also that I felt like my greatest in speed, right? There is real value at a time like that, right? So often, the perfect can be the enemy of the good in decision making, and particularly at a time where, literally, as I was saying before, every day we had major decisions to make, that getting into debates that could paralyze decision making can be a mistake. And I think the decision I made at that point was that we ought to get started. And ultimately, that's what we did. We got started, and then we made changes along the way. And I felt, as I looked at the team, there were a lot of brilliant economists and others on the team who, I couldn't compete with in terms of certain knowledge. What I knew is that I brought in more detailed knowledge of how the housing market functioned, and particularly the way that all of these complex mortgage instruments functioned. And I knew that operationally, they were nowhere near where they needed to be in terms of actually executing on this program. There were ideas about the design of the program, but the fundamental thing you have to realize, when we got a lot of complaints that we were doing a lot to help the big companies, the big banks, and not enough to help individual homeowners. Well, just think about this. You have a choice between doing 5 or 6 transactions with the biggest banks, or if you want to take on the housing challenge, you literally need to take on millions of individual transactions. That was a fundamental challenge that we faced. And so the operationally, starting from literally ground zero, we didn't have any programs in place to do this. We didn't have any mechanism to do it. It's not like there was an existing government program that we could just piggyback onto. We had to create it from scratch. And so what I ended up diving into very early on was saying, where I think I can add value, the specific skills that I bring that nobody else has in the same way on this team are to really help solve the problem of how do you take this idea for a program and turn it into a program and execute it in a way that you can literally reach not just a few banks. This is why the Bush administration gave up, by the way, on trying to help homeowners directly. That was their original plan. Okay. They ended up deciding to just go directly to banks and try to stabilize the economy through that because it was just so much simpler. Because you could do a half dozen or a dozen deals with these banks, and hopefully that trickled through the economy. We made a different decision. We felt we had to help homeowners directly, but the complexity was
so daunting. On that note, everything you're saying here, I don't read necessarily when I go back to the news back in 2009, 2008. Why was it so difficult to talk to the press and explain the difficult trade-offs that you were facing as a leader in that situation?
Well, I think one thing is we just, and you know, President Obama talks about this, we didn't have time. I mean, when literally every day we were making the scale of decisions, you also have to think about it. Early on in an administration, we had a very large segment of our cabinet confirmed early on, but most folks didn't have press officers. I didn't have a communications team. We were still building those, so that compounded the challenge of not having a lot of time. We didn't have other people whose job it was, in many cases, to do it. But I also think it goes to the heart of something that is, I think, very challenging about our press environment. And I have many friends who are reporters who work in the press. The pace of the news cycle is not matched up to a problem of this scale. The need to report on a daily cycle, even on an hourly cycle or a minute-by-minute cycle, doesn't give, or it's very hard to carve out time in that media cycle to dig into a problem of this complexity. And so when it takes a number of months to get the machinery that I talked about set up, what you get is impatience, right? Why isn't it, you know, here are your numbers, here's what you committed to do, why aren't you getting there? These moral hazard questions that I'm talking about. And I think particularly the moral issues, and the Rick Santelli clip really goes to this. I think one of the real challenges we have in the media in the US is that our media is becoming more and more polarized. That sort of middle ground objective position isn't heard as much. We all tend in the, you know, internet reality that we live in to get into our own bubbles, to hear the news that we want to hear. And I think more and more media tends to be catering to those positions. So you tended to have liberal media on one side that were saying, you're not doing enough faster, you should be helping every single homeowner, not acknowledging some of the moral quandaries that I talked about. And on the other side, why, you know, the Rick Santelli view, why are you doing this at all? Why are you helping losers with their mortgages? Why are you using taxpayer dollars, throwing good money after bad? And finding that more nuanced, the place we were trying to get to with our policy, trying to find that in the media was difficult. And I worry about whether the press model that allows sort of longer term but more balanced reporting, whether that's can be monetized, whether it's sustainable in this kind of media environment.
So I want to move forward the discussion 1 year later. The crisis was further exacerbated by mortgage fraud by the banks. So in about spring 2010, there was clear evidence of mortgage fraud. The five largest mortgage servicing banks were accused of running a wide-scale practice of robo-signing. That led to issuance of improper mortgages, premature and unauthorized foreclosures, violation of homeowner rights and protections, use of false and deceptive affidavits in courts, and the waste and abuse of taxpayer funds.
Is that all?
You tell me. But what made, from what I understand, the situation particularly complex is that you had a battery of diverse stakeholders that complicated the crisis. So the US Department of Justice launched investigations at the banks. The 50 state attorney generals launched independent investigations at the banks. You had hundreds of individuals and their lawyers launching lawsuits at the bank. And then you had about 10 federal agencies, including yours at HUD, with a whole set of claims against the banks. Now, you took the lead in those negotiations. And 2 years later, you managed, I don't know how, but you managed to get all the major stakeholders into a collective agreement. The agreement is called the National Mortgage Servicing Settlement. It has three components. One, the banks agree to abide to stronger mortgage servicing standards. Two, the banks agree to pay about $50 billion of assistance to homeowners in general. And three, the banks agreed to pay an additional $2 billion of direct aid to those homeowners who lost their homes. That settlement had a major impact, and I quote from DOJ websites, "The unprecedented joint agreement is the largest federal state civil settlement ever obtained in the history of the US." So when I go back to this map of stakeholders that you were working with, could you begin briefly by elaborating on what each of those stakeholders got out of the settlement and why they might have been worse off otherwise?
Yeah, so just like many people thought I was crazy to agree to become HUD secretary at the beginning of the crisis, there were a lot of folks who thought I was crazy to take this on as well. And I will tell you, I thought I was crazy a bunch of times. I'd never been in a negotiation. You've got the five banks on the other side of the table, but as you showed, just on my side of the table, I had over 60 different negotiating partners, right? Between the state attorneys general, all the different federal agencies. And so the first thing I would say, and I think this is true in general in negotiations, but it's particularly true when you're going to take on one as crazy as this, you've got to be really, really sure up front that there's something in it for everybody. And so this question is important because I think you've got to have a clear vision in your mind when you enter a negotiation of who's going to get what from it, and is it enough? Because if it's not, you shouldn't get started, particularly with something this complicated. I think on the bank side, understand that what they were looking at was, and let me just say this more broadly, actually, what was the status quo? If we didn't reach this settlement, what was going to happen? You would have had potentially hundreds of lawsuits that would drag on for a decade, two decades. Millions more people would lose their homes. We'd continue to have not only robo-signing happen, but, you know, folks losing their homes, home prices dropping another 10, 20, 30% in the US. And so I think the fundamental bargain here was, from the bank perspective, they were willing to pay more than they thought was reasonable if they got everyone around the table, or just about everyone around the table, to hold hands and agree to the same thing, right? From their perspective, and having worked in finance, affordable housing finance, worked with mortgages before, I understood this. The idea of, I'm gonna have different rules, 50 different sets of rules in 50 different states going forward. I'm gonna have litigation that will mean properties are locked up for 4 decades. And then on my side of the table, certainly for me as the leader of this, what I saw was the potential, not just for what DOJ wanted, right? DOJ wanted to punish the banks for wrongdoing. They wanted to recover funds for the taxpayer because taxpayers were hurt by this. There were federal mortgages here, FHA, which is part of HUD, Fannie Mae, Freddie Mac. I wanted not just that, but also I thought this could be used as a way to limit the damage from the crisis. Not only to get help to homeowners immediately who had been harmed by the robo-signing, but also more broadly, potentially, to get assistance before the problem happened, right? To reduce the outstanding amount of mortgages.
The ones for next in line.
Right, that there was some prevention here as opposed to just righting the wrong that had already been accomplished. But that was tricky, right? There wasn't anything squarely in the letter of the law that said we could do this. And the attorneys general were particularly interested in these servicing standards, right? So to be able to say not just let's get compensation for the damage that's already been done, But on a forward-looking basis, could we establish a set of standards that would govern what the banks could and couldn't do going forward? And in fact, those standards ended up being adopted by the CFPB, the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau, which had the authority to write standards. They weren't even part of the settlement, but it ultimately became a model that was then adopted in lots of other places to create a higher standard, but a more consistent standard. So it was this fundamental pairing of getting more for homeowners than we otherwise would have been able to get, getting more for taxpayers, but in exchange, getting a consistency that would cut across. And that was, I understood that, and I think a few of the attorneys general understood that that was possible. I had a fantastic partner, Tom Pirelli, who was very senior at the Justice Department, who saw this and was bought into it. And it really was that original vision, which over 2 years, it must have died. You know, cats have 9 lives. This thing had many more lives than a cat. But ultimately, it was that initial understanding that everybody could walk away with something at the table that was of value to them that hung together and allowed us to get the deal done.
So how do you negotiate with 60-plus stakeholders? Do you bring them on the table like we're now and get everyone on board?
Absolutely not.
It's not something that I imagine.
That complete disaster. Look. Ultimately, and this is true in any dynamic, the more complex, the more important it is to do this, is to understand who are the leaders that are sitting around the table with you. And I identified there were two of the banks, the CEOs of the banks were engaged, or the CEOs of the mortgage companies were really the lead folks, and there were two of them that I identified who really wanted to get this deal done, and I thought would actually spend the time and effort and had the stature within the bank community. And so I went and spent a significant amount of time with the two of them, and almost before every meeting, I would, or Tom Pirelli from DOJ would be in touch with them, trying to make sure we were going into that meeting, seeing things as closely as possible. We had lots of fights with them as well, but it was really key that they ended up taking the lead on their side. We did the same thing with the attorneys general. There was one Republican and one Democratic attorney general that each became the leaders for their groups of attorneys general. We identified which agencies of the many, many federal agencies were actually sort of active partners and who was just along for the ride. There were many of them that thought, this is, you've bitten off way more than you can chew, Shaun. You're never gonna get this done. It's impossible. And you know, they basically said, look, if you can do it, great. We're willing to be, but we're not gonna spend much time on it. So I had to sort through which were sort of in that camp. And then I think there were a couple folks we had to identify who were the most skeptical, but if we could win them over, they were key to getting the deal done. The California and the New York attorneys general on the Democratic side were those people. Big states, big claims, lots of legal powers that were important with the banks, but also skeptics initially. And on the Republican side, there were a couple equivalent, Virginia, one or two other states on the Republican side that were similar. Florida was the other one. And so it was really a question of a sort of analysis of who was sitting around the table and who could be leaders within their own pieces of the negotiation that would allow us to get it done.
So what did you do with those leaders for those 2 years? How did you get them to view the big picture and finally come to an agreement?
Well, one thing was just, I often say to work in government, you need to be patiently relentless. I was patiently relentless. I scheduled a regular meeting in my conference room at HUD every 2 weeks. I made sure we had cookies at every one of the meetings. That was actually written about in the press. But literally, it was partly, it was just when they saw that I was going to be, I was going to spend a significant amount of my personal time.
Right.
It was an unusual thing to do for a cabinet secretary, is to put as much personal capital and time into this. And I will also say it was a risky thing for me to do. There were other members of the cabinet in the economic team who were very skeptical, never thought I would get this done. And so I spent a significant amount of time with the president on it as well and made sure that he was supportive. And in fact, he kept bugging me every time I saw him. Are we close, Shaun? Are we gonna get there? And when we finally inked the deal, it's the only time I've ever busted into the Oval Office unannounced. I just walked past his secretary. He wasn't even in the Oval Office. He was in his private dining room eating something. I interrupted his lunch. One of the bigger hugs I've ever gotten from the President of the United States. So, you know, there were small things like the regular relentless pressure. And it was critically important that the president was supportive. Because I will say, there were moments where this became dicey for us. There were difficult politics on both sides. Like the other mortgage programs, we got criticism from both sides. We weren't going far enough. We were asking too much. And it would have been easy enough, because it took so long, because it was dead so many times, it would have been easy enough for the president just to say, this is too costly for us. Right. Too many news cycles that we've been through where, you know, we don't have something to announce. And a lot of it was that key direct support from my principal that I had to get it done.
So that last point that you mentioned actually gives us a great transition to get to part two of this discussion, which is talk more about your leadership style and how you're able to adapt to different types of crisis. In particular, the veteran homelessness crisis and Hurricane Sandy. One of the patterns that becomes really clear in those two crises is you follow an uncompromising pursuit of an effective solution. For example, let's talk about the veterans first. It's a major problem in the US. It's been there for decades. It's on the rise, actually, during the Great Recession. In 2010, there's more than 70,000 veterans living on the streets. June 2010, the Obama administration implements a new plan called Opening Doors. The plan proves to be remarkably effective. Year after year, the number of homeless veterans goes down to being fewer than 40,000. Now, one of the key defining features of that plan is that it takes a really new and unconventional approach to an old problem. In the previous approach, a veteran is offered shelter, offered treatment against various types of addiction. There's a carrot to provide permanent housing if the person is responding positively to the treatment. And the program is really targeted to provide incentives to reward good behavior, so to speak, but in practice, it's ineffective. Now, you push for what is called the housing first approach, and from what I understand, it's an approach that you had seen back in New York in the 1990s. It takes the problem and takes it completely the other way around. The veteran is offered lodging first, unconditional priority lodging, and then offered treatment. And the idea here is that if you promote housing stability first, that is going to make the treatment more effective. That's one type of an effective policy in this particular problem. Another example, which is quite different, a very different type of crisis, but we see the same pattern, is Hurricane Sandy. It hits the east coast of the US in October 2012. The consequences of the storm, they're huge, more than 100 casualties, more than $65 billion of damages, more than 650,000 homes damaged by the storm. HUD has a major disaster recovery program whose job is to rebuild infrastructure, replacement housing, assist businesses, help the homeowners, and essentially restore the communities. And it also has a second part, a second mission, which is to plan for long-term resilience to natural disasters. And on that part, once again, you push for an unconventional approach. You create what is called a rebuild by design competition. It's a new competition where the teams are going to go and spend 7 to 8 months on the ground, literally, to talk to all the stakeholders and try to build a more holistic approach to resilience planning. In 2014, HUD allocates close to $1 billion to 7 winning ideas that are currently in the works. And so here we have two different contexts. And in both cases, you seem to pursue the effective solution. And that may actually be influenced by some of the earlier experiences you had in the Great Recession. Can you talk a bit about what are the difficulties of going with such an effective solution right away? I'm assuming that it must create quite a bit of controversy, especially with those who have invested so much of their time building and implementing the previous approaches.
Yeah. Look, I think in most societies, the vision of an inventor, of an innovator, is the sort of lone, it's the light bulb going off over somebody's head and the sort of lone experience of creativity and genius, right? And certainly, you know, I went to architecture school, that was certainly sort of in the bloodstream of it. And I think that's one thing for an individual pursuit. But government is a team sport. And the thing that I think is critical when you're trying to innovate and do something new is really understanding where the edge of the envelope is, how far you can push the status quo before it breaks, before you actually do more damage than is worth. Because there is the risk, if you get it wrong, right, that you set back the very cause you're trying to help. And I think in both of these cases, as I reflect on it, the key was sort of stepping right up to that precipice, but not falling over. And so maybe to put a little more texture with that, I actually started volunteering at a homeless shelter in college. It's how I got interested in housing to begin with. And so working on homelessness was something I was quite passionate about. This problem of veterans homelessness in the US, when President Obama came into office, a veteran was twice as likely to be homeless as the average American. Think about that. Twice as likely. These are folks who have risked their lives for the country and yet come back home. And so the first thing I did, I knew that if I was going to have an impact on this, I needed to be like locked arm in arm with my colleague who ran the Veterans Administration, the VA. And so I went to see General Shinseki, who had been named to be VA secretary. Wonderful man, decorated general, 4-star general, incredibly strong moral compass. He became well known for actually standing up against the Iraq invasion and actually getting fired for it when he was in the military. And I went to see him. What was very clear from the beginning was that I had a completely passionate partner. I mean, he was literally almost in tears talking about having spent time with veterans who were sleeping on the streets. What was also clear, and this goes back to the charts you showed, is that housing first was like, seemed crazy to him. And I just want to put a little bit of a finer point than you did on it. He said to me, so let me get this straight, Sean. We're going to give alcoholics and drug addicts housing without any commitment that they're going to stop drinking or taking drugs. Is that right? I said, yep. That's the way the program works. I'd had to sell this to like community organizations in New York. Yeah, we're going to bring housing to your neighborhood that has drug addicts. Right? It's a popular thing. And ultimately, I mean, I showed him the data. I showed him the results. The truth is, it's really hard to take your medication, to stay in a program, or do whatever you need to do when you're sleeping on the streets.
Yeah.
And evidence shows. And again, this is one of those tough moral issues that, you know, like in the housing thing, we had to confront. And ultimately, what I knew is that the VA, like the military, is an organization that's very hierarchical. If I could get the VA secretary believing housing first worked, then we could actually make progress. But if he wasn't, we were going to get caught up in hundreds of different ways within the bureaucracy at VA. And so for me, it really began with that. The other key one that happened a little later, Michelle Obama, the first lady, was very passionate about veterans issues, worked a lot with Jill Biden on the issues. And I knew we had to win over the mayors and governors around the country, because ultimately there's only so much we could do on our own. And so I had the idea to get Michelle Obama to lead an initiative to invite all the mayors and governors to the White House and challenge them. We ended up coming up with a plan to end veterans homelessness in 5 years. We ended up cutting street homelessness in veterans by 60% in 5 years. So we didn't quite get it, but we set a big audacious goal. And I'm a big believer that if you don't set big audacious goals, you're not gonna make rapid progress. But we couldn't make progress if we didn't have the mayors and governors committed. So what she invited them all and put them all on the spot and said, we want you to commit to end veterans homelessness. We now have over 100 different cities and states that have ended chronic homelessness for veterans, and some that have started to end all homelessness.
New York recently announced.
New York, state of Connecticut, state of Virginia. So there's real, and a huge part of that just came from the podium that a president or a first lady, that bully pulpit is incredibly powerful. So those, I think, were the two key kind of early strategic decisions that really allowed us to make progress. On Sandy, again, this issue of how far you can push the envelope, I want to be very clear. You've talked about one piece of our response. And again, I want to put it in a little more stark terms. Taking $1 billion to build infrastructure and other kinds of investments, but particularly infrastructure, that is going to stop a storm from damaging a place 10 or 20 or 30 years in the future is not a very popular political thing, right? You could take that $1 billion and put it into that infrastructure, or you can take it and give it to homeowners or business owners who are looking to rebuild.
Right.
Right? And you can guess which one is, you know. So I was gonna do something risky in trying to do this much longer term thing. But I also knew that if we did a bad job on the short term, because we had $60 billion, right? Let's be clear, this $1 billion, I wasn't spending everything on that. But what I knew is that if we screwed up on the short term stuff, if we didn't get money to families, get that started immediately, if we didn't get money to homeowners and others, we were gonna be dead in the water, so to speak, on the other side. And so it was a both and thing where we had to do the traditional response and we had to do that well. And that would perhaps create some space to do the other piece as well. The other, a little bit similar to the mortgage servicing settlement, I needed the president, because this was one, he did get calls from senators in, you know, saying, why are you taking $1 billion to do this, you know, long-term thing? Like, we need that money going directly to folks. And at the end of the day, his support made a huge difference along with others. You know, the other thing was governors and mayors, that really the governors in the region, the mayors in the region needed to lead the recovery. The federal government is really in a more secondary role. We provide the big checks, but they've got to implement. And so I spent a lot of time with the governors and mayors to help them understand what the potential was for their communities. Right. And we ended up having a few real champions. The mayor of Hoboken loved this idea and became a huge champion for it.
Hoboken was one of the most damaged communities.
One of the 80% of the housing was flooded in Hoboken. And she ended up being ultimately one of the winners in the competition because she got so behind this idea, spent a huge amount of time building a really great proposal for it. So,
another key pattern of your leadership is your focus on on using quantitative measures to drive optimization and collaboration. You view performance management as an effective tool. Now, what is performance management? It's the clear definition of objectives and priorities. It's the use of simple and quantifiable metrics to evaluate performance and reward success. It's a consistent monitoring of the metrics to ensure that the goals are being met in an efficient manner. You're a very strong advocate of data-driven performance management. This is back from an interview in September 2009. The question was, how do you measure success for HUD? Part of your answer was, well, we've put in place a host of benchmarks, some internal, becoming more performance-based and data-driven, bolstering relationships with local partners, others external, making the prevention of homelessness and measures of all the program successes. Could you explain how that focus on quantitative measures helped so much to bring down the number of veterans in that first in the first crisis?
So, I get the best way for me to describe it is that for most people in government, success is not clear. And I kid my friends who work in the private sector, oh, you guys have it easy. You manage in two dimensions. We in the public sector have to manage in three dimensions. And what do I mean by that? You know, if you have a bottom line in the private sector, and I'm simplifying here, obviously, that's a clear definition of success for a particular unit, for a company, whatever it might be, is profitability. In government, it's not even clear oftentimes who we work for, right? Are we trying to, in the case of the homeowners, is it the homeowners who should be first in our mind? Is it taxpayers and protecting them? Is it the 500 board members you have up on Capitol Hill who, you know, all have a particular district that they care, right? And it quickly starts to get very complex in government to figure out what does success really look like? And so I think performance management's important in the private sector. I think it's especially important in the public sector because often it's the most powerful way to align, not just inside your organization, but outside as well. So take veterans homelessness. This was something I didn't have to create passion around ending veterans homelessness, right? I talked about the VA secretary almost being in tears. Like everybody believes veterans shouldn't be sleeping on the streets. The question is, how are you gonna get there? And when we were willing to step up and say, we wanna drive this to zero, and we're gonna actually set year by year targets for how to get there, all of a sudden, what was a more amorphous challenge started to become much clearer. And then we literally started organizing around, okay, well, how much money would it take to do that? And we figured out the 25 places in the country that had the biggest veterans homelessness problem, and we started tracking each one of those and meeting with the mayors and the governors. And so it really became a way to create buy-in. I would also say, and I hope we come back and talk about this more, too many folks in government, all they get is criticism for what goes wrong. And Lord knows they don't come into government for the stock options, right? When you can set specific goals and meet them and celebrate those goals, it's amazing the way it starts to create a sense of momentum and buy-in and excitement within a team.
So I understand very well, I can very easily visualize how that could work in the context of the veterans. How do I make that work in the case of Sandy and long-term resilience, given that we're preventing for a storm that may not happen for another 50 to 100 years?
Well, you can damn well believe that we had very clear goals around the other stuff that I talked about, right? How many homeowners had their homes damaged? How many have gotten help? How many businesses? I had my team building charts looking at how fast we were getting assistance to people relative to past storms. So there's a whole range of ways that was more immediate. I think it's a very fair question, though, on something where not only is it very long term, right? So, but it also is something it's a tail risk, right? You may be protecting against something that may never happen, right? So on the first one, I think you have to be very clear about creating intermediate or shorter term goals, right? Because quick wins are always really important. People are gonna lose energy, they're gonna lose commitment if they don't have a sense, wow, I've accomplished something, that we've reached a goal. And so a big part of that for us was we knew that these projects weren't going to get implemented unless we had a range of folks working together effectively at the local level and in all the federal agencies. So I had a sense of whether it was going well or not by how the collaboration was going. We were actually doing surveys and other things of our partners to figure out, was there support or not for what we were doing? Was there buy-in? Were these things going to be able to? And then there are also, technology is kind of amazing in allowing you to begin to understand things that are quite far in the future and quite obscure. I one of the things that I did early on was decide, the president asked me to lead the long-term response to Sandy. That was in November. I was planning to go to Berlin with my family for New Year's to visit some friends of ours. You can imagine how my kids responded when I told them that we were gonna take a few days of our family vacation and go visit flood protection measures in the Netherlands. That was really exciting for them. But we did, and one of the things that I saw there, I had these 3D goggles on watching the city of Delft flood from a 3D model that they had created. The Netherlands has now 3D mapped the entire country down to the half meter. That was a few years ago. They're probably even finer resolution now. And they can run simulations on any piece of infrastructure that they would think about putting in place, right? So there are ways like that. Insurance premiums are another very good thing. One of the huge things that created the political motivation for Hoboken, the flood insurance premiums were sky high because of the vulnerability of the place. And if we could get insurance companies to believe through the modeling that we could show that this was better protecting the community, you could actually get an immediate, it's a feedback loop that's more immediate. It's also a real win for the local community, right? So you have to be a little more creative, but you can often find ways to think about what does success look like here, and not just in the very long term, but in the shorter term as well.
So that leads me to my last question of the discussion before we move on to the Q&A, and it's a bit of a broader question, and that is, how do you build a culture of risk-taking initiatives in the public sector? As the cartoon shows, the federal agencies are not known to be the best at promoting risk-taking initiatives from the local employees, but in the two crises that we've just talked about, you're getting the agencies to move. You're building momentum. Can you shed more light on how, in general, you can make this happen and in a way that lasts, outlasts a particular leader?
Yeah. So if you'll permit me a short story, which is sort of my version of this cartoon. I was sitting with Mike Bloomberg one night after dinner. We'd had a few drinks. And he said, "Shaun, you know what the problem with government is? I take somebody who at my company, at Bloomberg LP, is a rock star. 3 out of 10 of their ideas are home runs. That's a person that I promote. And more importantly, I take money away from the 7 things that aren't working and I put them towards the 3 things that are working. I take that exact same person and I put them in the Bloomberg administration. They probably get fired because 1 of the 7 things that goes wrong ends up on the front page of the New York Post. And more insidiously, I have to take money away from the 3 things that are working and put them towards the 7 things that aren't because it's a crisis and it has to be fixed." Now, the private sector isn't the same as the public sector. Some of those 7 things that are going wrong probably do have to be fixed because kids may be dying or other things would be happening. But there's a fundamental truth, I think, to what Mike was saying in that there is such an asymmetry of incentives for risk-taking in government. And this goes back again to the idea of why create, what is success, defining success, celebrating success, that so often what I find in government is somebody who's been there 20, 30 years, if I scratch below the surface, that's somebody who came into government for all the right reasons, is passionate about doing things that make a difference in people's lives. But over time, all of the incentives not to take risks have made them into somebody that too often won't try something new, right? Won't be willing to innovate because it could end up on the front page of the New York Post. And so I think a huge part of the challenge I have seen as a leader in government is how do I create a reason to try something new? How do I create a reason to innovate? Mm-hmm. And then also, how do I let that person on my team know that if they're doing the wrong thing for the right reason, that I'm not gonna bite their head off? If they get a bad story because they tried something new, if you're not trying new things, by definition, you can never fail, right? What do we're in Canada? What did Wayne Gretzky say?
What are you talking?
He said that the only shots. Damn. Get it right. You never miss the shots you never take. Something like that, right? And that's what you have to do as a leader, I think, is figure out. I remember one time that I screwed up on something and I got a call from Mike Bloomberg on my cell phone. He almost never called me on my cell phone. So I was nervous. Something had just gone wrong. He asked me 3 or 4 questions about it. He got comfortable with the fact that I had the right motives. I wasn't just being stupid, but I was trying to do something innovative. He said, "Do it again, Shaun." And so how you communicate both the value in risk-taking, celebrating that, but also at the same time having somebody's back when things go wrong, I think is a huge part of that, creating that culture of risk-taking. And I think that's, President Obama was, you know, they call him No Drama Obama. One of the things that I think was incredibly important in his leadership is that he wasn't gonna make a snap judgment when, you know, we talked a lot about those kinds of things today, whether it's on the mortgage servicing settlement, early on in the financial crisis. There are a lot of times when he could say, "This is too hard politically for me, I'm taking too much heat." He would always say, First, tell me what the right thing is to do, and then we'll figure out how to do it. And that's what I think you have to do as a leader if you want to create space for risk-taking in government.
Well, thank you.
Thank you.
This concludes the discussion part, and now we have time for questions from all of you. I took up too much time myself. We have two volunteers in the room, and if you can please indicate your interest to them. I do have three rules, though. One is, please wait until you have the microphone to start speaking, because otherwise we will not hear you. Two, keep it short. And three, no more than one question per person.
It's clear that you and the rest of the team manage the crisis. The question is whether the crisis has been solved or is it ongoing. If one thinks of the income disparity, if one thinks of the lack of opportunities for employment, particularly for younger people, if one thinks of the ill-preparedness for major catastrophes, one has to ask whether all the good things that you've done or tried are working sufficiently well. After all, if nothing else, one of the reasons Trump got elected is because there is a certain amount of dissatisfaction with what happened during the Obama administration. So how does one make the transition between handling and between solving?
Yeah. So I guess I would say we can't let the perfect be the enemy of the good in this conversation either. I don't think that you use the term solving. I don't think these are problems that get solved in a few years. And ultimately, I think the question the president, President Obama asked himself, the question I asked myself is, did I leave this agency, this country, better than where I found it? And I would strongly argue, even on all the points that you made, which I would agree with. Is there too much inequality in the US? Absolutely. Are there huge challenges remaining? Absolutely. But fundamentally, first, on the acute economic crisis that we faced, is it better? Absolutely. The US is in the middle of the longest streak of job growth in its history. And unemployment's below five. Almost any measure you could say, is the economy stronger than it was? Absolutely. That's different from inequality. Inequality continued to grow for many years of the administration. But over the last 2 to 3 years, we've seen a significant closing of that gap. We've actually seen incomes grow at the low end of the spectrum in the US more than any year on record. We had last year in 2015, we had the single biggest drop in the poverty rate, the single biggest growth in incomes that we've seen in the US. So I believe that we did the right things to make a huge difference in these on these challenges. Did we solve them? Absolutely not. But I think we had a set of policies, we made a set of choices that were leading in the right direction. Now, we don't have enough time to go into everything I think about the election. But one thing I will say, and I think this is may or may not be sort of reported outside the US in terms of the nature of the challenge we face. But let me frame it this way. I grew up in New York City. I was born in 66. And so the urban challenges that I remember were highlighted by the South Bronx burning, by watching the neighborhood around Yankee Stadium. I'm a big Yankees fan. I used to go there all the time as a kid. That neighborhood lost 90% of its population in 10 years. And if you look at what's happened in urban areas in the US, it is a remarkable turnaround. Interestingly, sadly, what we're seeing is a very different story in rural America. We have, for the first time, really in modern history, an entire group of people whose life expectancy is going down. White, primarily male, in rural America between opioids and a set of other challenges. And so I think when you talk about sort of what led to the election results, where is the dissatisfaction, what is going wrong, I think a lot of, and I'm painting with a broad brush here, but there is a significant challenge in rural areas in the US that is a huge economic and moral problem. It's also a political problem, but to me, that is a large, not the only piece, but a significant piece of what we saw in the election.
Hi. I happen to be in business, and you look like the nicest guy in the world, but you must have been carrying a big stick when you sat with the banks, who really messed it up to start off with. And the Lehman brothers hang over their heads a little bit. And I'm sure you said a few things that maybe you're not saying here, but you have to be of carrying.
I'm a New Yorker, so my language wasn't quite as polite at times. That's correct. I would also say that they understood that their legal responsibilities and legal risk was enormous. So I didn't have to necessarily swear at them or anything like that to convince them of that.
Mr. Donovan, at the same time that the economic crisis was happening, there were still a lot of other things on the policy agenda, right? The Affordable Care Act, crises that in foreign policy. How does being part of a cabinet, right, and in many ways being part of the president's management team, how does that come into play, the sort of balancing of not only the tasks that you had that were both long-term and immediate, but a host of different policy conundrums, right, that you were right in the middle of? How does that happen?
Yeah. It's a good question. And as the president, I think he said early on, you got to be able to walk and chew gum at the same time. I guess my single biggest lesson I would take on that is that the most important decision you make as a leader is who you pick for your team. And I think the biggest, let me talk about the public sector here for a second. I think the biggest mistake I see most leaders make is that they believe that there's too much importance in their own decision making and not enough importance in the decision making that their team makes. I set a pretty high standard to overturn a recommendation my team makes. And I think that's often because they know a hell of a lot more about the issue than I do. They're closer to it. But there is also something about making sure somebody who works for you knows that they have the authority to do things. And if you want them to be creative and to innovate and take risks, the last thing you should be doing is micromanaging and watching over them. So that's a big part of, go back to performance management. If you get results, God bless you, go do it, keep doing it. And I think this is also part of the problem of what makes for a lack of risk-taking and innovation in the public sector, is that way too often you get a bad story, something goes wrong, and all of a sudden you start micromanaging that person. No human being, I don't care how good a manager you are, how good a leader you are, you can't solve 18 different things at once. You need a team to do that. And so there is, and I've seen this both in President Obama, and I talked a lot about him and about Mike Bloomberg. A huge part of what they were doing was deciding when they should be getting involved and making decisions and when they should, when it's best to leave it to your team. And I think, you know, one of the best skills that I learned was what were the two or three questions I needed to ask to get comfortable and then let folks go. That is what ultimately that's what allows you to work on six or eight different really hard problems at once. Pick the right people, let them go.
We have time for one more question.
You've spoken a lot during the interview about clear criteria for success, performance metrics, and a data-driven approach. Many times when you measure something, people start acting and performing to the measure, and they're not doing necessarily what you want them to do. Can you talk about the challenges that you may have had in coming up with the right metrics?
Yeah. It's a big problem. There is no question that when you know, people manage to what you measure, and there are things that are really hard to measure, and that creates a problem. The answer to that is not to measure things. The answer to that is not to not measure things. You can't throw the baby out with the bathwater, but it is a really important issue. And I think it's complemented by the balance that the temptation to solve that is to have more metrics, right? Is to measure 10 things in a problem or 20 things because, oh, well, you know, this is sort of the perfect becomes the enemy of the good, because once you lose the clarity and simplicity of folks having a limited number of things, then I think you really start to, you lose the power of it. So it's a really hard, in addition to picking the wrong things, there's the how many things do you pick problem that's really important. What are the things that balance against that? I think it's one, picking really carefully. I've also tended in the organizations I've run to think about a sort of pyramid of metrics where, you know, for me, for the most senior leaders in the organization, you have a few things. There might be a very different set of metrics for a different part of the team that really get to some of the things that might go wrong if you're just measuring the, you know, two or three things. But it's thinking about it as, you know, different teams have different metrics. The other thing is frankly, you know, human beings matter too. And, you know, in the homelessness thing, there was one amazing woman at HUD who ran a big piece of the homeless thing. By the time I left, she was running the whole program. And, you know, I'd go to her and say, like, we didn't talk about this, but I started what I called HUDstat meetings. And we ran one on veterans homelessness. Every month, we had the senior leadership from VA, a huge group of folks around the table. We were looking at, you know, how are we doing on our numbers nationally? We were drilling in on specific places. How are we doing here or there? And I would go to Anne, who was the woman I was talking about, after some of these sessions and say, does this make sense to you? Are we missing something? And she was somebody I knew would say to me, Shaun, this is stupid. You're measuring the wrong things. Or like, you know what? Those folks are just telling you what you want to hear. They're blowing smoke. But really, this is the issue you ought to, right? So there are ways, I think, of getting underneath those problems to start to really understand whether you're measuring the right things. The last thing I would just say on it, and this is an important part of HUDstat, we would often kind of drill into specific places. We'd say, you know, something's happening in Las Vegas They're moving really fast. They're leasing up units. They're bringing more veterans off the street. Like, let's send a team out to Las Vegas and look at what they're doing. In other cases, it was the opposite. This place is doing really badly. Let's send a team out and figure out what. Now, one of the things that we would get out of that was innovation, right? Often in the federal government, you're sort of focused on dictating out, here are the rules, we're going to tell you what to do. But the federal government's operating in every single place in the country. What better place to figure out what's happening, what's innovative that's happening, right, from those local communities? And what we ought to be doing is having a feedback loop where we're hearing from those places, getting those innovations, and then spreading them around the country. But what we would also find sometimes from these teams was they'd say, you know what? What we're measuring doesn't make sense. They're actually doing well in these places, but we're not capturing it in our data. Or they're doing certain things well, and what's showing up in our data, right? So there are ways, I think, of testing it by going and looking at and kind of drilling into specific places so that you don't kind of create the illusion that just looking at a set of metrics, you know, on my desk every week is enough to really understand whether you're solving the problem or not. It's got to be balanced with other tools that sort of create some accountability for the metrics as well, if that makes sense.
Thank you all for joining us. This concludes the discussion.
Thank you. Great. Thank you.
Friends, once again, I'd like to thank you for joining us tonight. We are very fortunate to have spent the last hour with both of you, so I would really like to thank Secretary Donovan and Professor Betermier for being with us tonight. It was quite a learning experience for myself, actually. I think a lot of lessons of leadership here can be applied to university setting as well. We have a very small token of appreciation, so I invite both of you to accept these small gifts. And I'd like to invite all of you for a cocktail, which is going to be served right next door. So please enjoy the evening and talk more about leadership. Thanks.